Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Tam Nguyen, and I'm your host for today's Facebook Live. With it being the beginning of the new year, many people are working on fitness and weight loss goals. Today, we'll be talking about how the team at Northwestern Medicine's Digestive Health Center is helping our patients on their weight loss and weight management journey. Joining me today is Dr. Eric Hungness, bariatric surgeon, and Dr. Catherine Tomasino, clinical health psychologist. Welcome. Thank you for being here today.
Thanks for having me.
So to start off today's Facebook Live, I'd like for you to meet Jessica Koss. Jessica has a sensational story about her weight loss journey that you really just need to hear. Jessica, welcome.
Hi, everyone.
Hi.
Hi, Jessica.
Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
So, Jessica, thank you so much for being here today. Let's start off with why you decided to come to Northwestern Medicine's Digestive Health Center's weight loss surgery program.
Northwestern has always had a very good reputation. My mom takes care of herself here. So I figured top-notch hospital, why not? And then I met the team of doctors, which was the icing on the cake for me to stay here. A lot of information I got, and I was convinced that this is the right place for me to be.
So what was your experience like going through the weight loss surgery program?
It's been one crazy ride.
Yeah.
Totally worth it. The surgery was just a jump kick of my new healthy lifestyle. You know, the doctors, Dr. Hungness was my surgeon, so he was very thorough in everything and explained my process. I learned a lot with the nutritionist. I learned how to keep, you know, high protein, low sugars, low fats, and I just took off with that. Cut out a lot of sugars and just went through the whole process. My journey started after the surgery.
After the surgery?
Yes. Once I went home, cleaned out the cabinets, and bought everything healthy. Read labels, didn't buy anything that wasn't within what I learned through the 6-month process prior to my surgery.
So you went through this whole lifestyle change. So what's next for you now that you were able to lose your weight, change all these things in your life?
Next for me, I'm at a fitness level where I've never thought in my entire life I would be. It would be skin remover surgery, and I want to do a fitness competition.
Oh, a fitness competition.
Yes, that's my next goal.
Wow.
Yeah, it's really cool.
So you'll have to let us know when you do that so we can come
cheer
you.
Oh, for sure. It's going to be a process, but that's on my bucket list.
That's amazing. So, Dr. Hungness, you know, we hear so much about patients like Jessica and, you know, about how obesity is becoming more of an epidemic. Like, why do you think that is? Like, what are some of the trends that's happening out there?
Yeah, I mean, it really is becoming a major health crisis in the United States, and I wish I had better news as far as the trends were concerned. When I first started in this with weight loss surgery in the early 2000s, I would say the national data showed that about 30% of patients were classified as having obesity.
30%.
Right. That was with what's called a body mass index greater than 30.
Okay.
But now, over the last couple of years, that rate is now approaching 40%.
Wow.
So unfortunately, despite all the efforts that we've been doing and other programs have been doing nationally, there are millions of people that are out there suffering with obesity and the medical problems that go along with that. That's really where the problem lies. It's not so much the weight itself, it's the medical problems that come along with the obesity.
Yeah. So it sounds like programs like our weight loss surgery program at Northwestern Medicine Digestive Health Center is really important. But can you tell us more about the program?
Yeah, of course. The program is really designed to be a comprehensive program to come alongside patients who are ready to to take the next step in their health journey or their weight loss journey. Mm-hmm. We help provide resources to them, learn about what weight loss surgery is about, what the changes are going to need to be made, what the surgical options are, and then give them a glimpse of what life like is afterwards. Obviously, the patients have to live it and experience it themselves. But that's what we try to do. And to do that, it takes more than just doing an operation. It takes bringing a whole care team of surgeons, health psychologists, dietitians, mm-hmm. And then we have bariatric coordinators, and it takes a whole group of people in the setting of a great healthcare system like and a hospital like Northwestern Memorial Hospital mm-hmm. to help patients along the way.
And my understanding is that the program's a center of excellence as well.
Right, and so so we've been designated a center of excellence. Mm-hmm. There's a national certification, but also insurance companies can certify programs like ours as centers of excellence. And what that means is that we've achieved our patients have good outcomes, low complication rates. And again, we approach this more from a disease standpoint, more than just a disease standpoint. It's a holistic standpoint about again helping our patients mm-hmm. with their health and weight loss journey.
Yeah. So, speaking of holistic programs, Dr. Tomasino, your portion is a very big component of our weight loss surgery program and really weight management program and obesity program in our center. So, can you tell us a little bit about why clinical health psychology is so important to programs like this?
Sure, and I really like talking about this because I think that sometimes patients hear that psychology is involved in the journey and it makes them a little apprehensive.
Yeah.
They're like, why do I have to go see a psychologist? What are they going to uncover about me? Mm-hmm. Or maybe they think that we're trying to prevent them from having the surgery. And in fact, it's actually the exact opposite. Mm. My goal whenever I meet with a patient is really to partner with them to help them and the team help them have the best outcome after surgery. We were talking about this a little bit earlier. Weight loss surgery is not a quick fix. I think there's that misconception out there that mm-hmm. if I have the surgery, I'm going to lose the weight. But it's not a quick fix, and it takes dramatic changes of people's behaviors, daily habits, and lifestyles after surgery. So that's really where psychology comes in, because that's our area of expertise, is helping people make those changes to their lifestyles and their behaviors.
Yeah.
So we meet with people all along that journey, both before surgery and ideally also after surgery, during those, especially those first 6 months, first year, when people are making these big changes and adjusting to the weight loss. So it can be an adjustment for patients and their families, friends.
Yeah. So, I mean, what are some of the frequently asked questions that you get from patients who come see you for their...
On top of why am I seeing you, which is often a first question, we get questions about how can I really cope with the fact that sometimes I turn to food when I'm feeling really down, or sometimes I turn mm-hmm. to food if I'm overwhelmed. What can I do about that? So that's exactly what we work on with people then, is learning other strategies aside from food and helping control the environment so that that really delicious food isn't readily available. And that's part of what's contributing to the obesity epidemic, really, is that we have these high-calorie, high-fat foods that are so conveniently accessed and get them anywhere. So helping kind of set some parameters, helping patients set their lifestyle up for success.
Wow. So we've talked about some surgical options for weight loss surgery or weight management. What are some of the non-surgical options that a patient might want to consider?
The nice thing is that the Digestive Health Center also houses the Center for Lifestyle Medicine, which really specializes in those non-surgical options mm-hmm. for weight loss. So there are medical providers, dietitians, and psychologists within that program too. And patients might meet with a medical provider to get a weight loss medication that could help decrease appetite, and in some cases maybe even curb cravings. Mm. Or meet with a dietitian and get a tailored plan that's really individualized to that person about dietary changes they can make. And then meet with a psychologist to talk about some of those things we mentioned earlier, like how can I cope in different ways aside from food, or my lifestyle is super busy, I can't imagine fitting in exercise or making the changes I need to make, like cooking. Can you help me figure out how to do those things.
And so fit that into all of our busy lives.
Yes, absolutely.
So, when might a patient consider bariatric surgery? At which point, Dr. Hungness or Dr. Thomas, how do you decide that? I mean, surgery is a very big deal.
Mm-hmm. I would say when I meet with patients and I kind of ask them, why are they considering this?
Yeah.
They've reached a point where they realize they can't do it by themselves anymore. They've gone through the roller coaster ride of losing weight, regaining weight, losing weight, regaining weight, or they've been diagnosed with a new medical condition.
Mm-hmm.
They've just gotten the news that they're diabetic, just like their parents are, and now they think about all the complications that potentially their parents have had with diabetes, and it really just brings home that I need to do something, I need to take control.
Yeah.
And that's where you know, if they haven't really, you know, been trying, we can hook them up with, you know, with one of the medical weight loss providers. But if they've been doing that and then they realize that that's not been effective, mm-hmm. then surgery is a really good option. It's, mm-hmm. it's been clearly shown that it's the best option to achieve sustained, significant weight loss over a period of time. And that has translated not only to improved weight loss, but that those medical problems can go away. Mm-hmm. So it's not uncommon that I see a patient a year out from surgery and they're off a bunch of different medicines. Huh. And they're just, you know, again, not only have they lost weight, but they're healthier.
Yeah. Jessica, what was it for you? I mean, what was the defining moment where you decided, okay, I really need to consider surgery?
It's like the doctor said, I was in the yo-yo. I would lose a couple of pounds, yeah. gain that and some. But then it really hit me when my general doctor told me, okay, you're diabetic. You're a certain amount of milligrams. We need to double it twice a day. Mm. And I said, okay, enough is enough.
Yeah.
I was having restless nights and I was telling her, you know, I can't sleep. I'm up till 2-3 o'clock in the morning. I sleep mm-hmm. for an hour. So I had diabetes, I had high blood pressure, and I also had sleep apnea.
Wow.
So I said, okay, enough is enough. Yeah. I need to get my life on track. I need to stop these yo-yo diets and get serious about this. And that's when I turned to the doctors.
Yeah, I mean, and Dr. Tomasino mentions, you know, this is not just a overnight process. How long was it? What was the duration of your experience from when you first decided to, all right, it's time for me to get surgery, to when you achieved your weight loss goal?
I think I reached my goal,
yeah.
within the year.
So it was about a year.
Mm-hmm. But I'll be 5 years out this coming April.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, very exciting.
I've kept it off. I've gotten really, really tiny, what they say. I've gained some, but like I mentioned earlier, I work out twice a day, sometimes 5-6 times a day.
Wow.
Yeah, people at the gym know me. I have an amazing support system, not only with the doctors, mm-hmm. I have a support system at home, mm-hmm. My gym family, mm-hmm. My personal trainer, he's always on top of me. Okay, you know, you need to, well, how's your workout looking out today? You know, it's really, really a change.
Yeah.
And it, like I said, it hasn't been easy. A lot of sweat and tears, but I'm there, I'm consistent. And like I said, my goal is a fitness competition, and I know I got a lot more to go.
And it sounds like you have a team and a fan club rooting you on along the way.
I do. I share a lot of my stories, a lot of my before and after pictures on Facebook, and I get a lot of feedback. I always celebrate two birthdays, my birthday in February and then my rebirth birthday in April.
Aww. So I like that.
Yeah, I always do that. They're like, well, didn't you just have a birthday in February? I was like, yeah, but this is my, like, the new Jessica birthday. So I celebrate both.
You have a whole season for your birthday.
Yeah.
And so your birthday's coming up in a couple months then.
Yeah.
That's great. Well, it looks like we have a question from our Facebook audience out there. So Betty would like to know, how does lymphedema relate to obesity, and is there a treatment for it?
Betty, thanks for your question. Lymphedema is and obesity aren't necessarily related. They can be, but a lot of times. Weight loss surgery is not something that will address some of the issues with lymphedema. I know that there are some specialists that can help with that process, but even if patients lose weight with weight loss surgery, sometimes the lymphedema or the swelling in the legs from that can persist.
And for those of us who don't know, what exactly is lymphedema?
So lymphedema is a condition where some fluid builds up in the cell in a lot of times in the legs,
okay.
and it can't get back to the heart and so forth. It's unrelated to like congestive heart failure. It's not in the vein. It's not in the veins.
Okay.
It's in the lymph system.
Okay, interesting. So, Dr. Hungness, you also published a research article in the Journal of American Medical Association called Partnering Behavioral Modification with Bariatric Surgery. What are there any highlights or findings from that that you think our Facebook audience might be interested in knowing?
Right. So I'll have to clarify. We actually didn't, publish the article.
Okay.
It was more, we made a commentary.
Great.
About the article.
Thank you.
Because we really liked the article a mm-hmm. lot. And it kind of reinforced some of the things that we think about in our program.
Okay.
What it did is it looked at some nationwide data mm-hmm. of patients that had weight loss surgery, and it looked at which patients maybe lost weight, the weight loss differences, and some of the behavioral changes that the patients made, and how those behavioral changes impacted weight loss.
Mm-hmm.
So for patients that were continuing to eat after they had a sense of fullness.
Mm.
For patients that continued to have kind of grazed and kind of ate throughout the day and kind of grazed, those patients actually did not lose as much weight as patients that incorporated some of the ideas that the health psychologist and Dr. Tomasino reinforce. And mm-hmm. so,
any thoughts on that, Dr. Tomasino?
Just basically, that is exactly what
yeah.
we focus on at the behavioral modifications after bariatric surgery. We know that when people do graze, I talked to people about that from the very first visit, because grazing is something that can definitely negatively impact outcome after surgery. And frankly, when people have a plan for fixing that, then they're okay. There are also things like loss of control eating that can make it difficult to change some of those behaviors. But even setting up your life so that it's easier for you to plan out your meals ahead of time can really make the behavioral modification a lot easier. And that's the key,
yeah.
right? That's the key for long-term success.
Wow. Dr. Hungness, just FYI, Tracy said Dr. Hungness is an awesome surgeon.
Hey, Tracy.
We agree.
Yeah.
With all of these New Year's resolutions we've got going on, I mean, there's, you know, I read a lot online about fad diets and things like that. What are some of the pitfalls that we want to avoid in some of the things that are out there on social media? Like, how can we become a more informed group or audience in terms of the best approaches to managing our weight? What do you guys think?
When you first started asking that question, the first pitfall that came to mind for me is an all or nothing approach, right? Mm. So a lot of people start the new year going at 150%. Everything is, everything's going well.
Yeah.
They're committed to their exercise. They're not eating sweets. Maybe they're doing a dry January, so no alcohol.
Yep.
Everything's full gear. And then something happens. They have a bad day and they fall off track. And rather mm-hmm. than just looking at it as a bad day or a bad moment, they start looking at it as the end of their plan. Oh, well, mm-hmm. I failed. So I'm not going to succeed this time again.
Mm-hmm.
And what we're really looking for and what we know leads to long-term success is more of a flexible approach.
So what does that? What does a flexible approach look like?
A flexible approach looks like sometimes people do get off track,
mm-hmm.
and being a little bit more gentle with yourself.
Mm-hmm.
It's normal to get off track every now and then.
Mm-hmm.
Even people who
have lost a little weight.
So forgiving yourself. We sometimes try to coach ourselves into doing better by being kind of mean to ourselves, and what we actually see in the research is that that tends to backfire.
Mm.
We feel worse, and then we're more likely to give up.
Mm.
So that flexibility and more gentle approach is actually better. And then also starting off a little bit slower can be effective. If you go and start off going to the gym every single day 5 to 6 times, you're probably going to give it up in a day
mm-hmm.
rather than starting off with 10 minutes, 20 minutes and building that stamina up.
Okay. That's a really good point. I mean, that's the first thing, right? Gym memberships soar
mm-hmm.
in January and everyone's trying to go every single day. Jessica, was that how your transition was to you kind of built up to your routine now?
I was going, when I first started, I was going for an hour a day, at least 4 times a day.
Okay.
And then
4 times a day?
I'm sorry, 4 times a week.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
No, it's just, whoa.
I do twice a day. Now I do twice a day.
Yeah.
But I'm
very impressive.
I always want to prove myself wrong.
Yeah.
So I always want to say, okay, well, if they can do it, why can I not do it?
Yeah.
I can try. The worst thing that could happen is, you know, that I fall and get up and do it again. So I joined a competition at the gym.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's when my trainer really got into it and started mentoring me. Okay, you know, if you do this in the morning, you'll not that you won't succeed, but that it'll work faster. You'll be more. What's the word that I'm looking for? It'll work at your benefit if you do this. So I was going in the morning. I do an hour of fasted cardio, and then I turn right back around, and I'll either do another hour of cardio or a weight train.
So more of a routine,
right,
for you,
right?
Got
and
it.
I just really got into it. I was like, I want to win this competition. I want to win this competition. Mm-hmm. And it's a thing that he always says. He says, it's not easy being sexy. So that always stays with me. So I was like, okay, I'm in there. Sometimes I'm there at 4 in the morning. Sometimes I'm there at 5 in the morning. It all depends. Mm-hmm. I have a full-time job. So, and like the doctor says, I meal prep.
Yeah.
So I meal prep every Sunday. Mm-hmm. I cook every 2 days. I not only because I love cooking. I'm the type of person, I'm an emotional eater. I'm happy, I eat. I'm sad, I eat. Mm-hmm. You know, I had a great day, let's go eat. Mm-hmm. I changed all of that. Mm-hmm. And I do eat, but I eat healthier choice. I make healthier choices. Wow. When I have a cheat meal, my cheat meal is a salad. They're like, that's not a cheat meal.
Yeah.
And I go, well, to me it is because it's off of what I'm typically meal prepping.
Wow, we are so proud of you.
Thank you.
She clearly, it's not a quick fix for her.
It's not.
Right. And the success that I think that you've been able to achieve is just because it's really been a team approach.
Yes.
And you've been diligent about it. And I'm sure you've had your ups and your downs, but you've had the good support. And,
yes.
And that was one of the things, we have a monthly support group, and we built that into our program. Mm-hmm. And I think it's so important to just have our patients realize that everything's not going to be perfect.
Yeah.
There's going to be some valleys along the journey, and we're going to just come alongside you and try to get you along the way. So,
I love it. Well, it looks like we're just about running out of time. Thank you so much, Jessica, for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much, Dr. Tomasino and Dr. Hungless, for being here with us as well, and for spending time today talking to us about obesity and options for weight loss and how Northwestern Medicine's Digestive Health Center can help be a resource for those of you out there who might be ready to start or continue your weight loss journey. And thank you to all of you out there for tuning in and spending part of your afternoon with us. If you would like to learn more about the Northwestern Medicine Digestive Health Center, please visit our website at dhc.nm.org, or call us at 312-695-5620. Or for specific questions about our weight loss surgery program, please call us at 312-695-7070 or visit us at nm.org/WLS. And thank you again and have a great rest of the day.